actually supposed to co-preach this together. Team preach, we enjoy doing a lot of things together. But then he decided to go to Camp Kalakwa for the Pathfinder Camp Re. So I'm glad that he did that because I know he's having fun. And when he called me this morning to see how I was doing, all I could hear were drums in the background, the drum corps playing. So it was pretty cool. He says there are about 5,000 people. I knew that it was a large group that attended the Camp Re, but I just didn't realize there would be that many people there. So anyways, he apologizes for, oh, that's the feedback, me hitting this, so I'll try not to do that. He apologizes for not being here, but he sends his love, and with that, I'll get started. All right, there's a Bible verse, and we read verse 44 of Mark 12, but I want to start with Mark 12, verses 41 first. And I want to assume that most of us are familiar with this story. Mark 12, 41 through 44, but it is up on the screen, just in case you want to follow along there. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins, worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, this poor widow put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all that she had to live on." Now let's look at a couple of reasons why this widow might have given everything that she had. There's the first reason, and that is for recognition. I know some people, they give because they want praise. So that could have been her motive, you know. She wants to be recognized. Oh, thank you, sister, so much for your gift and your offering. We really appreciate it. We're gonna put your name here, and we're going to parade around the streets. Now, that's highly unlikely. In fact, she tried to kind of go incognito. She was embarrassed about the amount of offering that she was going to give. So she tries to go and drop her offering when no one's looking. Look at all these rich people giving so much money, and she just has a few cents. How embarrassing. She didn't want the priest to see her because she felt ashamed. She didn't want the rich people to see her because it was nothing in comparison to what they were giving. So no, she did not give for recognition. There's a second option. Maybe she gave out of desperation. I'm reminded of the widow of Zarephath in Elijah's day. And you can find that in 1 Kings 17, 7 through 16. Now, her story is a little bit different. She gave, but she gave out of desperation. You see, her plan was to eat her last meal and then to die, right? But then the prophet Elijah, he comes up to her and says, "Okay, if you give me your last meal, the Lord will provide flour and oil for you until the famine stops." Well, we've all heard the saying, desperate times call for desperate measures. And, you know, to her it sounds cuckoo. It sounds outrageous. But a lot of times when people act out of desperation, it's because they have no other option. And their acts are very rash. And they're acting in a rash way in hopes to gain a highly unlikely positive outcome. So she's desperate. She's like, "Well, I'm going to die anyways. I might as well trust this man of God, this prophet, and give." So she gives out of desperation. So let's look at this widow again in Mark. Does she give out of desperation? We don't read in the story, "And she gave her two copper coins, went away, and died shortly after." The story doesn't read that in the Bible. We, just like the widow, have the faith that the Lord would take care of her, although she gave her very last. So no, she didn't give out of desperation. So that leads us to our third option, and only option. She gave out of deep devotion and love to God. Deep devotion and love to God. In Desire of Ages, page 615, this is what it reads. Watching her opportunity, she hurriedly, you know, she doesn't want anyone to see her. She hurriedly threw in her two mites and turned to hasten away. But in doing this, she caught the eye of Jesus, which was fastened earnestly upon her. The Savior called his disciples to him and bade them mark the widow's poverty. Then his words of commendation fell upon her ear. Of a truth I say unto you, this poor widow has cast in more than they all. Tears of joy filled her eyes as she felt that her act was understood and appreciated. She believed in the service of the temple to be of God's appointment, and she was anxious to do her utmost to sustain it. She did what she could, and her act was to be a monument to her memory through all time and her joy in eternity. Her heart went with her gift. Its value was estimated not by the worth of the coin, but by the what? Love to God and the interest in his work that had prompted the deed. So you see, she gave out of deep devotion and love. That's why Jesus was so moved by her offering, was so touched by her gift. And that's why he wanted us to be drawn to this story, to her story. And that's why we repeat the story over and over again throughout the ages. And that's why it's a monument for us. And that's why her story is a great example of what it means to give. You see, because her giving hurt. Her giving required a sacrifice. Her giving was one of loss and detriment. Let's keep reading. The rich have bestowed from their abundance. Many of them had been seen and honored by men. Their large donations had deprived them of comfort, or even luxury. They had required no sacrifice and could not be compared in value with the widow's mite. She deprived herself of what? Wow. She deprived herself of food in order to give those two mites to the cause she loved. And she did it in faith, believing that her heavenly Father would not overlook her great need. It was this unselfish spirit and childlike faith that won the Savior's commendation. Are you listening? I have a question for you. When was the last time your giving hurt? It's a question for me too. Jaela, when was the last time your giving hurt? When was the last time our giving required a sacrifice? When was the last time our giving caused an inconvenience for us? You see, a lot of us, we want to relate with this widow. We want to identify with this widow in the story. We say, oh, we're the widow in the story because we live from paycheck to paycheck. I give my tithe, I give my offering, and then, man, after that, I have nothing left, you know? Pay my bills, and that's it. I'm just waiting to get paid next month. It's a struggle. But do you have clothes on your back? Do you have more than a couple of pairs of shoes? Do you drive a vehicle? Do you have a cell phone with extra text messaging? Y'all's quiet, come on. I may get a few amens. Do you have a job? If you answered yes to these questions, or at least most of them, you'd better start identifying yourself with the rich people in this story. You see, because a lot of us, we give, but it's still out of our luxury. It causes us no discomfort, no loss, no inconvenience, no sacrifice, because we're unwilling to give up our extra data plans on our phone, that premium cable for you millennials, that coffee in the morning, that Starbucks, Taco Bell run. Okay, I got a couple amens. All these things are luxuries. The unused gym memberships. Can I get an amen? We're unwilling to give up those things which are so important. But this widow, oh, she gave out of her deep, deep poverty. Now, there are some of you that are struggling, and you are going through deep poverty. Here are some words of encouragement. Next slide. Among the poor, there are many who long to show their gratitude to God for his grace and truth. They greatly desire to share with their more prosperous brethren in sustaining his service. These souls should not be repulsed. Let them lay up their mites in the bank of heaven. If given from a heart filled with love for God, these seemingly trifles become concentrated gifts, priceless offerings, which God smiles upon and blesses. So, Eddie and I, we left the seminary about a year ago to come here. Amen, praise the Lord. And, when we got to the seminary, the Lord placed it on our hearts that we should foster teenagers. Now, we had talked about doing foster care when we were dating and engaged and said, yeah, it's something that we want to do. It's something that's important to us. But then we got married, and the first couple of years, you know, it's like the honeymoon phase, and we're newlyweds, and we don't want to have, you know, kids living with us. So we said, well, wait. So 3 years went by. And then we're called to the seminary. And, you know, well, the seminary, it's not really a good time. I'm working full-time. Eddie's a full-time student who's also working. But then the Lord came to me, and he said, you know what, Jaela? You are always going to be busy. There is always going to be something going on. There is always going to be something happening. So you might as well get busy doing something for me. And over and over again, I was convicted. You know, yeah, I'm giving. We give our tithe and offering, and we volunteer at church, and we help with Sabbath school, and we lead out in praise, and that's giving. But I'm not giving out of my poverty. I'm not making a sacrifice. And so I said, okay, we're going to do it. So I started the mountain of paperwork that requires to become foster parents, and it's a lot. And the caseworker, she came to our house and she did a couple walkthroughs and gave us more paperwork, and we had meetings that we had to attend and all sorts of hours that we had to complete. And in the meantime, while that was taking place, we told our friends and family to pray for us and to pray that the Lord would bring the right teenager into our home. And you know, some of our friends and family, they were excited for us. And they said, "That's awesome. We know you're going to be a blessing. We know God's going to bless you, and we're going to pray." But then there are other friends and family that were, you know, they were worried. And I get it. But then some of them were just casting doubt. And it was negative. Like, you know, "Are you sure?" And especially teenagers. I mean, you know, you just can't trust them. They're manipulative. They lie. They're deceitful. You know, it's completely different than young kids. My friend, he says, "Aren't you afraid one of them is going to take a knife and stab you in the middle of the night?" And you're laughing, but it's a question you have to consider, right? Because that has happened before. Are you sure this is what you're going to do? Are you sure this is what you want to do? And we have to consider all that, and the doubt, and the possibilities, and the unsurety. But we said, "Hey, we're living this life of luxury. We got to get uncomfortable." So we proceeded. On May 28, 2013, we completed our application to become foster parents. That was in the morning time. And 2 hours after Eddie and I signed the documents, 2 hours, we got a phone call. That's how great the need is. That same day, it was Hope, our caseworker. She's like, "Hey, I know you just signed, but are you ready? We have this girl. Her name is Rakia. She has just gotten out of Berrien Springs Juvenile Correctional Center. She can't go home. She's looking for a place. Do you want to take her?" And we said, "Okay, bring her on over." So we couldn't, Eddie was in class, and I wasn't teaching at the time. I had a break before my next class. So I went to the courthouse, and I picked up Rakia. I'll show a picture of her. Oh, okay, the quality's not that bad. I had to take off my Instagram because my laptop ditz. I left it on top of the car and drove off. So all my stuff, and of course I didn't save it, so all my pictures, nothing's backed up. So anyways, I wasn't sure how the pictures would blow up. So that's Rakia on the left, obviously, that's me on the right. And she was 16. Well, she was 15. She had just turned 16 after a couple weeks after we picked her up. So she celebrated her 16th birthday with her. And Rakia, you know, she was a lot of fun. You can see right there, I took her to Cajada Springs Youth Camp. That was a couple of summers ago. And she got to ride horses. There's one more slide of her if you want to go to the next one. Oh, yeah, she went camping with us. She had never gone camping before. So we're like, "Well, you got to go camping, at least experience once in your life." Rakia, she loved a lot of things. She loved shopping. Man, did she love shopping. She liked doing her hair. She liked hanging out with friends. She loved playing board games. She liked playing dominoes. She liked hanging out with her friends, and our friends too, which is good because we're very sociable people and we like to hang out. So she liked to hang out with her young friends, but also our friends. She'd come along and have fun with us. And she liked boys. Wow. That was that was something. So you know, we had a lot of good times with her. But you know, we also had some really bad times. Some difficult times. There were dark days, very, very dark days. There was the constant manipulation, lying, stealing our money from us, not just us, our friends and family, her promiscuous behavior, sneaking out in the middle of the night with grown men, sleepless nights, the bipolar behavior that would pop up without warning. You know, those days hurt. Those days require the sacrifice. Those are uncomfortable days. But it was in those times of discomfort and pain and hurt that Eddie and I not only cling to each other, but more importantly, we cling to our Heavenly Father. And it was in those moments of sacrifice and hurt where Rakia was really paying attention. You know, she paid attention to us every day. And it was interesting, you know, when she came to our house the very first day, we had to set up some house rules, of course. But one thing that Eddie and I were unanimous on, we told her, we said, you know, Rakia, we go to church on Saturday. Jesus is a big part of our life. We love him so much. And one of the ways that we show that we love him and we experience communion with him is by going to church. And we would love it if you came to church with us, but we're not going to force you. You can come to church with us, you can come to Sabbath school, meet some kids your age, but we're not going to force you. You know, because Jesus doesn't force us. Jesus loves us, and he wants to have a relationship with us, but it's never out of force. And you know, most of the time she came to church with us. There are times when she didn't come to church, and she stayed at home, or she went off and did things with her friends, and who knows? We know that. But we wanted to demonstrate the love of God. You know, because sometimes we do things and we say, okay, God, we're going to do it, we're going to sacrifice, but it's on our terms. We're going to have this foster kid come and live with us, but it's on our terms. They better sit down, be quiet, and listen to what we have to say. No, no, no. They're going to listen to what you have to say by your actions. And so in those dark days, I mean, I had some extreme anxiety. I'd never had that in my life before. My blood pressure rising. It was in those days that I clung to God. And that he drew near to me. And it was in those times that Rakia could really see the love of God through us, right? All right, so Rakia left about after a year, and I was burnt out. I said, no, I'm not doing this, at least for a while. I need a break. She's driving me crazy the past couple of months. We were at our wits' end. And I said, no. And I had a negative attitude because I thought, you know, it probably didn't even make a difference in her life, you know. She's still choosing to do these crazy things. But, you know, the Holy Spirit came to me, and he's like, you know, Jaela, I'm the one who makes a difference. You're just my vessel. And I had to keep reminding myself of that. And he also said, I love Rakia more than you could possibly love her. I'm going to take care of her. So we knew that Eddie was going to graduate soon. And I said to Eddie, okay, let's try to expand our family for real. It's not like foster, but like, you know, let's try to have a baby. So he's like, okay. So, So we thought it would take a while because, you know, you never know. We have had some friends been trying to have a child for a while, and they haven't been able to. And I'm sure some of you can relate. But thankfully, we got pregnant within a short couple of months, and all was good. Well, we get a call from Hope, our caseworker. And she's like, we have a kid. I was like, listen, Hope, you don't understand. I need a break. And I said, the past couple of months, you know how it was. I said, plus I'm pregnant. I said, I'm not trying to be all stressed out. I don't want this fetus to be stressed out. I want to have a calm, relaxing, you know, 9 months. And she's like, okay, I get that. But I just want you to meet this guy. Just meet him. Well, you know how that goes. I'm like, okay, we'll meet him. So Eddie and I, we went. He had just gotten out of juvie and needed a place to go. So we met him, and of course we liked him. He was awesome. And we love him. His name is Donald. There he is. Oh, I just love him. He's awesome. Look at that smile. Look at those eyes. What a sweet guy. Donald, it was night and day between him and Rakia, the experience. And just his demeanor, his composure. Yeah, he had gotten into juvenile, but he was a kid that made a mistake, that had a rough life. He got out, such a sweet kid. There he is holding Micah. You see him? Micah's so small. Donald was 17, and he actually aged out of the program, but we allowed him to continue living with us because we weren't going to just kick him out in the street because we're like, okay, you're 18, bye, see ya. So he continued to live with us. And we told him, I said, hey, we're going to Columbia. We got this call to a church. You're welcome to come with us. And but he decided to stay in Michigan because he did have family there, and although it wasn't the best situation, it was still family, and I can understand why he didn't want to come. And so even though his experience was night and day, it wasn't stressful. I didn't have anxiety. He wasn't manipulative. He didn't lie. He was just a great kid. It still required a sacrifice, right? We still had to take him to his home visits, his doctor's appointments, his dentist appointments, his counseling sessions, his therapy sessions. We still had to take him to school. When he got a job, we had to drop him off, and then, of course, pick him up. He wanted to hang out with his friends or his girlfriends because he didn't drive. Actually, he did end up getting his driver's license when he was with us, but we didn't want him to have the car. So we had to do all those things, and then there are times when we had to sacrifice our plans, what we wanted to do. And you guys know that as being parents, right? Duh, welcome to parenting. But before it was just Eddie and I doing our own thing. So we had to sacrifice. It wasn't necessarily a bad sacrifice, but a sacrifice nonetheless. But I wouldn't have traded it for anything. Because once again, Donald was able to experience a different kind of Jesus. Amen. That he would not have had, maybe. I'm not God, I don't know the future. But I believe that he maybe would not have had he not lived with us. And he's such a blessing to our lives. And he always tells people, yeah, I have a little brother, his name is Micah, so. It's really cute. Love it. So since moving to Columbia, Eddie and I, we haven't done foster care. And, you know, we want to be open to it. Who knows? We're taking a break. We're focusing our energies on our son, Micah, who's a year. And maybe in the future, God will call us to be foster parents again. Maybe he'll call us to adopt. And if he does, I hope our heart's response, although it will be difficult, although it will be challenging, although it will be hard, although it will require a sacrifice, I hope our heart's response will be, yes, Lord, out of my poverty I give. And it may not be foster care. It may not be adoption. It might be something else. You see, because I don't want to get in the trap of saying, okay, I did my good deed, and now I'm off the hook, right? Because I know I've fallen into that trap before. Oh, I've done something good, so now I don't have to do something good for a while. Or, God doesn't possibly require me to give and give and give and keep giving of myself. I mean, that's ludicrous, right? But what if he does? Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that every time you give, that's it. You don't know where your meal is coming. That you need to go hungry. That you need to neglect your family. You have a responsibility to provide for your family, to feed your kids, to put shelter over them, to clothe them. You have that responsibility. So I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is, be open to the Holy Spirit's invitation. If he calls you to do something, open your heart and say, here am I. What can I do? How can I get uncomfortable? How can I inconvenience myself? Because you have such a deep devotion and love to God. And it can be so overwhelming because it's like there's so many problems. Hurricane Matthew. Think of the devastation in Haiti. Think of the devastation we have right here in the South. That's just recent. But there's so many problems in this world, it can become so overwhelming and discouraging. And to think, I can't make a difference. You're right, you can't change the world. But you can make a difference. One step at a time. A person here, a person there. And that's what God is requiring of us. And I'm so thankful that we have the Father and the Son. They are truly our greatest examples, right? They gave. They sacrificed. Their giving hurt. The Father, he gave his Son. To me, that's the greatest sacrifice of all. I can't imagine, like, you guys get it now that you're parents. I didn't get it before. But my son Micah, I love him more than anyone I love in the entire world. And instantly, I would rather die in his place. I wouldn't want him to die. And I get it. Parents shouldn't outlive their kids. No parent wants to see their child pass. It's awful. It's heart-wrenching. But God, he gave up his son. That was so hard to see his son on the cross. Oh, I'm sure he wanted to take his son off the cross and say, okay, I'll go in your place instead. But he didn't. Oh, what a sacrifice. That hurt. That cut deep. And then you have the son. He sacrifices what? He sacrifices life. And one of my favorite quotes is in Desire of Ages. And I don't know the page number. But it says, Jesus did not consider heaven a place to be desired while we were still what? Lost. He left his life of privilege. Jesus got uncomfortable. He sacrificed. And even more importantly, he left that relationship with his Father. He didn't even want to be in heaven if we weren't there. That's the gospel right there. I can pray. I'm almost done, though. He didn't want to be in heaven if we weren't there. That was a sacrifice. But you know, he gave up his life, he rose from the dead, but the giving didn't stop after he rose from the dead, right? Because Hebrews tells us, Hebrews 7:25 tells us, consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. So we know through other scripture and spirit of prophecy that Jesus is what? He's up in heaven, and he's ministering on our behalf. He's doing that daily. And because he's ministering on our behalf, God shows favor on us and gives us blessings and holds back the wrath of Satan, blesses us every single day. You see, the giving of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, it just didn't stop after Calvary. They continue to give and give and give of themselves and bless and bless and bless. I don't know about you, but today I want to respond to that blessing. I want to respond to that sacrifice. I want to respond to that giving. I want you to stand today. If you want to get uncomfortable, I guess that's what I'm saying. And maybe God has put on your heart, and we can have some music playing while I do this. And you don't need to come up front, but if you want to start getting uncomfortable and living out of your poverty from time to time, then stand. Maybe God has put on your heart to give to the victims of Haiti. Maybe to help our brothers and sisters out in North and South Carolina, Florida, and Georgia. Maybe to sponsor a student at CAA or Mount Pisgah Academy. Maybe there's a neighbor you don't like. Maybe God's calling you to get uncomfortable and go after that neighbor. Maybe he's calling you to be a foster parent, and maybe he's not. Trust me, not everyone should be foster parents. Maybe he's calling you to give more. Maybe he's calling you to give 20% tithe or 15% offering. I don't know what his calling is, but you know. He's talking to your heart right now. He's tapping on that door. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, when we think about how much you gave for us, our giving really seems so little. It's really not that big of a deal. When we think about what you sacrificed, we gladly do it. Oh, because we love you. Oh, how we love you. Oh, how we love you. Teach us to love you more so that when we come to your kingdom, you say, I was naked. Oh, but you did not clothe me. I was hungry, but you did not feed me. I needed a place to sleep, but you didn't open up your house. You didn't get uncomfortable. Once again, Lord, we love you, but we want to learn to love you more. Thank you for your sacrifice. And thank you, Jesus, that you said goodbye to heaven. I'm coming to get my kids. I'm bringing them back. We love you. Help us to love you more. Amen.